Good afternoon, everybody around the world, and welcome to the Sunset Safari. For those of you who are joining us for the first time, my name is Jamie. I have Tibbs on the back with me, doing his usual fantastic camera work and leopard spotting. Out on Rusty, we also have Steph and Viam, the wildebeest. We also have Jerry and Kirst in FC, as well as Eugene, making sure all of the technical realities of a live safari are brought into a reality situation. And we are live. We're coming to you from Juma and Arethusa Game Reserves in the Greater Kruger National Park in the Sabi Sands area of South Africa. So welcome, and send us through your questions and your comments on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email them through to questions@wildearth.tv. So, still recovering ever so slightly from my sighting this morning. The one thing about live safaris is you never quite know how things are going to go on and what's going to be around the next corner. So for those of you who missed that particular sighting this morning, we had quite a serious skirmish between hyena members, and it was two females, one of which is the one that we think is the matriarch. We learned a great deal from it. It was difficult to see, and Brian and myself both agree it was one of the most intense sightings we've ever had in our combined years in the bush. The poor attacked and targeted hyena was seeking refuge underneath the back tire of the car and desperately trying to get away, and the vehicle actually started rocking as the other hyenas attacked her. So quite a serious attack, not as bad as the one that Scott had a couple of weeks ago, and maybe on about a par with the one that happened around the Juma Pan. So she's fine, the female's fine, she walked away from it relatively unscathed, injured back left leg, and her ears, as usual with hyena fights, were quite savagely torn at. We've been doing a lot of research in between our drives, and a lot of, I must thank you, all of the viewers, for sending through your screenshots and your interpretation of this morning's events. Just a rough summary to give my perspective, and from what I've double-checked from the screenshots that everybody sent through, as well as the information, I was wrong. Somebody picked up on it, and I'm really grateful for you for that information. Corky was not involved in the attack. The attack was pretty in that sighting, attacking the hyena, and it was Bella. Bella's mother that was also the main antagonist in that particularly, and she was particularly savage in that attack. And I think what we've learnt almost for certain as we can be in any kind of interpretation of these events, is that Bella's mother, big stocky girl with very dense spot concentration, she is the matriarch of that clan. I think it's almost certain. As to where the hyena with a big scar on her back is, we haven't seen her in a couple of days. I think the last sighting was around January the 6th. She's got a big scar on her back. She's the mother of June. I don't know where she is at the moment. I don't know how she fits into this hierarchy. What was interesting about the sighting this morning is that Bella's mother went back and came back to investigate the scene with Corky. So how this all fits in terms of the hierarchy, I would say Pretty and Corky are both fairly high ranking, particularly Corky. But it was an intense sighting. It was a highly emotionally charged sighting. The noises that come from the hyenas in situations like this are heartbreaking. So difficult to watch, but also an incredibly valuable learning experience. And thank you to all of our... Wait, let me get to the top of this rise first. There you go. And thank you to all of our regular viewers who've been monitoring the situations at the dens, and have actually sent through information that goes back to before I joined Safari Live. It's incredibly helpful to have your assistance in the matter and for pointing out the various aspects of the dynamics. Well, this afternoon I plan on checking around Juma for anything wonderful to show you. Then we will head back to the hyena den to sort of get some finality into that particular sighting and just close it off for all of us who were involved in it. But yes, a big thank you to you all. We do really appreciate your input as well as our own interpretation of events, and we'll never know. It will be a mystery forever after as to what was happening in that particular sighting and why it was that female was attacked. All right, well, that was all I really had to say in my introduction, and I believe that Steph would very much like to say good afternoon to everybody, so I'm going to send you across there.
Good afternoon to the Sunset Safari with myself, Steph. And we found this massive herd of bachelor bull buffalo. Generally speaking, they are in groups of four or five, and odd occasion we find them up to 10 or so. But here we've got at least, well, let me count them for you. We've got seven on the one side, and then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 on the other. So 17 bull buffalo. And I'm battling to find a single small one out of all of these 17. Actual fact, the one that you're having a look, or the couple that you're having a look at over there on the far right hand side, are some of the biggest buffalo that I've seen here at Juma in my time at Juma. Just take a look how low this guy's horns are hanging. When he's got his head up, his horns, the droop of his horns almost comes to below his ears. Very sharp tip. You know, you'd think that these guys would be in their prime. And it's not that these bull buffalo don't mate with females, they just don't hang around with the herd anymore. So they're in the home range of the herd that they're part of. It's just that they don't like the hustle and bustle or the attention that the herds of buffalo, or the breeding herds of buffalo, get. And so these guys, generally speaking, like to hang around in thick bush drainage lines, come out, lie in the mud, go back again. Now, obviously, Buffalzoek Dam is very dry at the moment, but there is still some water. Under this crust of mud, or dried mud, it's still very glutinous, and I'm looking at some puddles that I'm busy seeing that have gathered, and these are puddles not because of the rain, the recent rain. These are puddles that have come because buffalo have been stepping around in the mud. And I can tell you that this mud is busy, I don't know what it is, it's rotting, but the smell that is coming off of this mud at the moment and blowing into myself and VM's face is just something spectacular. It's making me want to cover my teeth with my lips and definitely not lick my lips clean. I'm wiping my teeth and my lips clean with my fingers. It is horrendous. What are you gonna do? Have a look at how many buffalo there actually are. Let me just try and get out of the way. Watching the acrobatics that we have to do to get out of your shot, or at least for me to get my pink bald head out of your shot. There's the rest of the group of the buffalo that were here. There's one or two giant buffalo in there. Huge bodies. You're looking at them weighing around about 800 kilograms. That's the weight of these buffalo, about 1600 pound. Have a look at that buffalo second from the right. Those backward swept horns. You can just imagine what a formidable enemy these buffalo would be. And it's one of the reasons why lion prides in areas where buffalo occur actually have to teach themselves how to hunt buffalo. Hunting buffalo is not a natural thing for a lion pride to do. It's something that they have to learn. And they'll learn it in areas where there is a lot of buffalo, like there is here in the Sabi Sands. They make it look relatively easy. I mean, those Birmingham boys at a stage were pulling down three or four buffalo a night. I have no doubt, singularly as well, they were busy pulling down buffalo on their own, which is not uncommon. I've seen a male lion take down a male buffalo on his own, but it is a titanic battle. Look at the buffalo that VM's coming onto right now. You can see from all his bush thrashing, all the wood and things stuck in the crevasses in his horns, and how shiny the top of his head is. Ooh, this mud is stinky. It smells like a mixture of algae, stagnant water.
Old towels.
The old towels, as Vim was saying now, dead fish. Yeah, it's not my favorite smell, I can be honest with you there. For those of you joining the show for the first time or are new to watching Safari Live and Wild Earth, oh, excuse me, saw the back of my head over there. Should have painted a face on it for as long as what you were staring at it. And this is Buffalzook Dam. You're on camera with myself, Steph Vinterboer, and VM is working the camera for us today. We've got another buffalo coming in at the back. This is Buffalzook Dam, one of the better game viewing spots that we have, although for the first time in Wild Earth history, this dam has dried up. And generally speaking, when I got here in May, there where that buffalo is at the back over there, the water was knee deep on that buffalo when I got here in May. After not such a heavy rainfall year, just an average rainfall year. And between then and now, it's just gotten gradually dry to where you see it at the moment. There's still water in here. I have no doubt that this dam is actually just below or above the water table. I think the water table is just below the crust of mud that we're seeing here. It's another massive buffalo, massive set of horns. Not quite as deeply curled as what some of these other boys are. For instance, the buffalo that's walking away from you in shot, he's got a very deep curl. The buffalo that's walking to his nose has got a very wide set of horns. And by wide, I mean probably from the outside bend to the outside bend, 1.5 meter. Much wider than what you think. Now this herd is not a structured herd. It's not a permanent herd. This is a bunch of bulls that are loosely associated to one another. They will be part of the breeding herd. They'll be part of the herd bulls, but they will not stick with each other all the time. They will come together and then they will move apart. And I think it's got a lot to do with companionship. It's got a lot to do with safety. It's got a lot to do with what area they're in, what predators are around. Juma is much bigger than where we can traverse. But where we can traverse, we haven't seen, or lions are moving through. We haven't had lions resident here for quite some time. And I think that those factors are having an effect on these buffalo numbers. And one of the reasons why these buffalo are here today, I think, is because there hasn't been much lion activity right in this spot and in this area for quite some time. It's not to say that the lions won't come back. In actual fact, I think that lions follow around these bachelor herd of buffalo, and I think that we can expect them to come around quite soon. Have a look at how deep the mud is there. That buffalo is about to sink belly deep into this cesspit. That'll give you an idea of how much mud is still below this crust. This crust's probably about 1/2 foot thick. And under it is this jelly-like mud. And into the mud, or into the cavities that these buffalo create, they hold water, and the water will seep into. And as you saw from the picture VM was showing to you, look at this buffalo digging there in the mud. It's where they get their name Dugger Boy from. So old male buffalo that hang around in mud pools like this are called affectionately Dugger Boys, which mean mud boys. Look at how sharp his horns are. He really has looked after his horns. The older they get, obviously the blunter the horns get to some, and at a point they will even break off. Some of them can break off. These definitely look like they can carry on going for another couple of years. Now, they generally become solitary like this from anywhere from about 6 to 10 years old, and they'll live up to about 20 years. I think left untouched here with the lion that hunt the buffalo here, I don't think they live much beyond 10 years if you ask me. Yes, he's having a proper mud bath. Mud helped to cool him down. It also helps to coat their skins, and when it dries and they scratch the mud off, it pulls parasites off of their skin. It masks their scent. And especially this mud, I think this will mask these buffalo from anything. And all the way from Denmark has remarked on the funny pattern that we see in the mud. It looks almost star-shaped. See, VM is pulling out there a little bit. You'll see that. That was literally the last pool was there at the confluence of all these white paths. And the white paths that you're seeing are where hippo moved in and out of the water. There were a couple of hippo that were in this dam the last couple of days before it dried up completely. There were a bunch of hippo, and that white mark signifies where those hippo paths were, and I'm sure that it's white because of either a different type of algae growing in that area. It's more than likely that. And that algae would grow on areas with a different chemical composition, and with it having a path where hippo used to be in and out, you're going to find the hippo urine and hippo dung there change the chemistry there, which is why you get that funny pathway there. So those pathways would have been where the hippo came in and went out of the water. And the confluence there where the big white mark is where they used to sit out the last few days here. This buffalo is waiting for the seep. He's now been here, he sucked it up in one hole, waited for the seep in another, and is now busy sucking up the water in the next one. See, another buffalo off to the right-hand side as well that's also sticking almost his entire face into the mud. Was that one? You can have a look at the dried mud on the back. He's already had his mud bath today or yesterday. And he'll then go and find himself a scratching post at some point and scratch that mud off. Also coats their skin, incidentally, against all the biting flies that plague these poor guys. I think they have a worse time than even I do with flies. You see, when buffalo run away from lion and leave their flies behind, you don't understand. If you're driving your vehicle behind these buffalo through their clouds of flies, it overwhelms the senses. Buffalo's having a good time in the mud. Now, they look quite slow and ponderous when they're walking around like this, but let me tell you something, they can shift when they need to. You're looking at a top speed of a buffalo at around about 55 kilometers an hour. And they can get up to that 55 kilometers an hour very quickly. Just skirting the outside of the pan there. Gonna go and join the rest of his bachelor herd. Probably in the deeper bush for the evening. Miguel has just commented on the fact that women spend fortunes on mud baths when these buffalo just sort of get it for free. Let me tell you, Miguel, the smell that's coming off of this mud, I wish your television screen was one of those scratch and sniff versions. You definitely wouldn't want this stuff packed on your face. I think you'll immediately die of some rather horrendous infection of some sort. Now, these buffalo look like they are leaving the pan. What they'd usually go and do now is go and lie up. I've found that on bushwalk, we found the groups of buffalo, or tracks at least of groups of buffalo like this, on the crest of the hills. And on the crests of the hills in this particular area, you get these thickets of monkey oranges. And the monkey oranges have, generally, they've got these clearings in the middle for whatever reason. I haven't quite figured out why the clearings are there yet. And inside these clearings is where you find all the tracks of these buffalo that have lain up that in those areas at night time. And I think what they go and do is they come for a drink during the day, lie up in the mud to cool off, and then as the day gets a bit cooler, they start feeding their way up the slopes, and they go and sleep on the crests in these thickets where it's protected, quiet, there's some good grass, and these thickets provide them some other type of protection, I'm sure. I'm actually quite glad that we got to see that. I mean, from almost 20 buffalo down to just three. There's the one on the dam wall, one standing hock deep, and then one on the other side of the dam in the mud pool that they created. He is just shiny with mud at the moment. Now that at least probably won't have this dead fish soup that the rest of this dam has got in it. And if I had to get covered by mud, that is where I would choose to go and go for the mud bath. I do find that these mud baths can be like quickstand for animals out here. The seep will happen in the middle of that mud. And what happens is some animals will come down, especially inexperienced animals. I've seen a lot of impala do it, young impala. They want the water, they're thirsty, they walk there, they get stuck in the mud, and that's exactly where they get caught and eaten. Crocodile, lion, leopard, I've watched them all go after animals stuck in the mud. Like that hyena come out covered in mud, but having gotten their prize. Ah, Jamie's got some monkeys in a tree, and before they flee, you're off to her.
Hold on, there it goes. You know when you just have one of those afternoons? Oh, we found one in the tree. Sorry, Tibbs, I wasn't even watching. I was looking at the one on the ground. We haven't quite lost the monkeys yet. But it's been one of those afternoons so far that our regular viewers will be familiar with, which is where everything runs away. Been trying to find animals to show you, and every time I stop to put them on camera, all we see is a bottom disappearing into the bushes. Luckily, this little baby monkey has decided to be a bit more camera friendly, sort of. No, I'm going to tuck myself in the most impossible position so that you can't look at me. Oh, hello. It's actually quite curious, I think. It needs to come and investigate from the safety of the top of this knob thorn. I always find it amazing the way they can pick their way around those knob thorns' thorns. What are you eating? Oh, that does not look safe. It's all right, little monkey. Munching, I think at this point, maybe on some of the leaves, but more likely trying to catch insects or something up there. Not much in the way of fruit on a knobthorn tree, just thorns. Watch the way it picks its way delicately down each limb. I'm going to sit down here where you can't look at me. Hmm. interesting to see how the different animals react to our presence. And there's certain monkey troops that are much more secure with the vehicles and others that are less so. We're sitting on the eastern boundary of Juma, and it appears as though this particular group isn't all that comfortable. And they are territorial in their own ways, these families of vervet monkeys. So you always have the same individuals in quite a similar area. Where's that other little one gone? Let me see if... I was going to say, let's see if it'll be more cooperative if I move, but it doesn't appear to want to be. Let's have a look. See if our monkeys will come out. Nothing wants to play ball this afternoon. I can see you. Sitting up there, looking down on me. Now, the monkeys this afternoon don't want to give us a clear view. No fly, go away. Stop trying to crawl up my nose. You guys hear that bird? Red-crested corhan doing its mating call. That sounded fairly close. Just trying to listen to where it came from. That'd be nice. It's been a while since I managed to put a red-crested corhan on camera. Let's see if I can spot it. Somewhere on the Torchwood side, I think. So this time of year, for both the corhans and the bustards, so those black-bellied bustards that we often see on drive, is breeding time. It's when they're at their most vocal. Now, I'm not sure about the other presenters, but I haven't managed to capture a corhan's mating display on camera yet, which is where the bird flies up and then drops its wings and tumbles out of the air until right at the last moment it opens up its wings and flaps down to a rather ungraceful landing. They're quite big birds, so similar to the black-bellied bustards that we often see, just a little bit smaller, about this big. Very cryptically coloured. No sign of it. Oh well, it was hopeful. And just an update, before we went live with the start of our sunset safari, I wanted to try and show you a unicorn. A unicorn. Well, yes, okay, let's go with a unicorn. I now cannot seem to call it an impala. The impala with the one horn and the damaged eye. He's still around. He's still alive. VM and I, after long debates and discussions, have decided that he should be called Two-Face, also known as Harvey, for those of you who get the reference. Just because he's got the most incredible on one side of his face. If his right side of his face is facing you, he looks completely normal. And then as soon as he turns his head, he's missing one horn and he's got a very badly injured eye. But you'll be happy to know that he is looking fine, looking absolutely healthy, and in fact is exactly where I left him. Exactly the same place on that road as to where we last saw him with, I think it was with Liam, a couple of days ago. He's not moving around too much, but he had a company of the other young bachelors of the other impala. And he's looking good. That eye's healing up nicely. We tried to start off the sunset safari with him, but as is par for the course this afternoon, just before that happened, he wandered into the bush and disappeared. back to our vervet monkey sighting. Country West, you wanted to know if vervet monkeys will raid nests. Yes, they will. They will raid birds' nests, especially at this time of year. Usually the smaller birds, and those birds themselves are not defenseless against their attacks. They will try and protect their brood. It's not as common as baboons. Baboons tend to raid nests fairly regularly, in my experience and from observation. I haven't often seen vervet monkeys do it, but they will do it. They will be perfectly capable of doing it. And those omnivores, they are fairly, what's the word? They're not hugely fussy about their diet. They'll try and eat whatever they come across. Are you two going to play along? Are you three going to play along? No. Here we go. A trio of waterbuck bulls. The only one who's being vaguely cooperative is this gentleman on the right. Now I'm chuckling at it, just because it's been the pattern of this afternoon, but the reason all of the animals are doing this, and I'm sure you must have picked up on it from the sounds coming through our microphones, it's very windy this afternoon, and it's making everything feel a little bit insecure. It's windy, it's also quite muggy. It's sitting at 30 degrees centigrade this afternoon, which is about 86 in Fahrenheit. So it's gone from our cool, cloudy, rainy days and back up to hot again. I wish the lower temperatures had lasted a little bit longer, or that we'd had a bit more rain. But I guess we've got to be grateful for the rain we did get. As my waterbuck very kindly wander off, I believe that Steph has a very large and tall gentleman to show you.
Well, welcome back to us. Our signal is a little bit jumpy, so you may or may not be able to see what we've got for you here, but let's see if we stop moving, we can get him. One beautiful camel horse with a necklace of red-billed oxpecker on him. And I know it's a male because the tops of his horns are bald. I know there's a certain kinship that I should be feeling with this giraffe. I just don't understand what it is. But have a look at those oxpeckers busy combing through the fur. He's got quite short fur. These red-billed oxpeckers will be combing through that fur to try and take the ticks off of him, clean him of mites, get rid of scabs. They eat a lot of blood. They clean up the giraffe's ears. They'll keep wounds clean. You see, very dexterous, and you can see they cover almost every inch, not letting a single morsel go to waste. They have these special combs on their beaks that allow them to effectively comb through the hair, and then they've also got quite a sharp hook at the end, which they will keep wounds open, picking away at dead flesh, keeping the blood supply flowing. He's in very, very good condition, this giraffe. You can see he's picking all the leaves off of that knob thorn, and I can't tell you how viciously hooked thorns that knob thorn has got. You cannot stick your finger close to that tree without getting hooked on one of those thorns, and this giraffe has just got his entire face in there. Not a care in the world. I've been lucky enough to feel the tongue and the lips and the cheeks of a giraffe, and it's absolutely not what you think. They are soft and velvety, very similar to a horse's. So I don't actually know how they don't get caught up, other than I think the skin will be very, very thick, very tough. Even though it's soft and velvety, I think it's quite difficult to break through. And that long nose with a mouth right at the end gives them the ability of sticking it way into the branches, keeping their eyes far away from pointy thorns. And then obviously the long neck allows them to feed at a height that other animals just can't match. The only animal that comes even close to them is an elephant. And they, elephants and giraffe, reach about the same distance above the ground at about 5.5 meters. And then obviously elephants can push trees down, which makes it a bit easier for them to reach even higher. Just have a look at this guy. He is in fantastic condition. Generally, giraffe of this age and of this size have these bald patches of fur, scars from sarcoptic mange inflictions that they have from time to time. And he just doesn't. He's just... And that's Okpek is taking his life in his hands, but not really. Have a look at that. Getting right in there. You'll notice all those little round grape-like things under the tail, those are ticks. I must be honest, it's something that I don't really, I'm shying away from trying to imagine what it must be like to have that many ticks in that area, and it's the thought is just horrifying. But ticks are common out here, and you can actually tell the condition of a lot of these animals by having a look at their tick loads. Ticks are common. Ticks only really get out of control when animals are in very poor condition and their immune systems can't fight off the ticks, and they can't move around, and they basically can't shed the ticks off. Ticks generally are only collect in these areas, these very special areas, underneath the tail, underneath the armpits, under the ears. And he doesn't have bad infestations of ticks in any of those areas. Now he's moving off. I think let's see, we're going to reverse a little bit so that we can keep him in sight for you. I think it's a good idea that we spend some time with him. It's always nice to spend time with the giraffe. They're quite peaceful animals. They can definitely alter a person's vocal, even though they
Rusty just dropped, but never fear, I'm sure he'll be back up and running very shortly. And you caught me in a moment just as I was trying to get an eyelash out of my eye. So hold on one moment. I'm going to continue to try and do that and drive at the same time and figure out where those wimbles are calling from. Ouch. Silly eyelash. I want to poke my eye out. I'm back on Central Road, and I thought I'd just do a quick double check and see if I could figure out where those kudu are that we've been following over the last few days, see if there have been any changes there. But also, I'm always in this particular area. Oh, hello, Steph. I'm always on the lookout for Karula in these particular areas, and apparently, this is the Steph we've had. Has had a similar thought process. Okay, well, he can head down in Yala Road South. I'll head up Central, and we'll see who finds them first. Interesting how the last few days, Juma's been absolutely packed with elephant herds. It's felt as though every single road we turned down has had a separate elephant herd on it. And all of a sudden in the last 2 days, they've completely moved off. It's just interesting the way they decide to move and how they move as a group. And move off as a group, even though they're separate individual herds. Of course, one aspect to that is the tannins that the trees are releasing, but the other browsers are still around. So tannins, for those of you unfamiliar, is the substance that trees produce. It makes them taste very, very bitter and unpalatable. And they start to secrete those chemicals when they come under, you could almost phrase it as coming under attack by browsers. Sticklers are shouting at something. So when they start to come under attack by browsers, they'll release these chemicals that then make them taste unpalatable, and the browser then moves on to the next tree. And it's one of the ways in which nature has evolved in order to stop trees being completely eaten to the point that they die. So it creates a sustainable use of those trees. Also, you'll notice that browsers, much like this herd of impala, will walk into the wind for two reasons. One is the tannins. So the production of tannins stimulates production of tannins in other trees. But also because obviously then they can rely on their senses in order to smell if there's any kind of threat moving ahead of them. It's quite a large herd. And again, much like that monkey that we saw, impala herds tend to move in fairly similar areas. I think this is the herd that we've encountered resting at Vulture's Nest before. All the babies clustered in the shade and the adults moving around on the outskirts. Here come some little ones wandering through. And still, even given their size, still bleating to mom occasionally. It's the noisiest, or the second noisiest, you'll ever find an impala herd. Get them all wandering down the road. Here comes the big ram at the back. Keeping order. Amazing to think that these are the little ones born only about 2 months ago. Less than 2 months ago. And the deep grunting sound that they make. They grow and develop phenomenally fast. Let's go forward a little bit, see if they come through with us. Oh, and there's some zebras coming across as well. Oh, that'll be nice. The impalas are going to have to make space for them. That zebra just chased them. That's interesting. Not chased them as in fully chased them, just sort of trotted forward and pushed them out of the way. Hello, zebbies. They can be surprisingly aggressive animals when they want to be. Nice opportunity to view the sizes of the two animals and get a little bit of a perspective and a sense of scale. Zebra's keeping a close eye on us. You can see how skittish everything is. It's this wind. They know what we are, but they're not quite certain how they feel about it. And the stallion was the one who pushed forward there and kept an eye on us. Off they go. Stopping to give us a disgruntled look on their way. Running again. Oh, it's definitely the wind. Or possibly they can smell some kind of, maybe it's blowing some kind of threat scent towards them. One of the predators, maybe. You never know. They look unsettled enough for that to be the case. I wonder if the lions didn't come through last night. It's difficult to see tracks with this kind of soil after the rain. But I wouldn't be surprised. Oh, that's the Impala's contact calling to their little lambs. Lots of Impala. I would say that there's easily 50 of them in this particular herd, all dotted about in this thick drainage line vegetation. Question that's come through from James Taylor about the impact of the drought the effect it's having on the animals. And James, you would like to know if an adult female antelope, for example, or any adult female animal that is lactating at the time, whether if the drought ever became so serious that they would be able to drink their own milk. The answer is no. They wouldn't. And they would not actually compromise their youngsters in that respect. It's amazing how strong that maternal instinct is. But no, and especially for Impala, short of applying for a job as a contortionist in a circus, it would be fairly difficult. Were possibly quite interesting to watch. But no, they won't drink. What will happen though, James, they will stop lactating. If the drought gets to a serious point and they can no longer supply the needs of their youngsters, their bodies can no longer cope with that pressure, they'll stop lactating. Luckily for these little baby impalas, they're actually almost pretty much out of the woods in that respect. So even if their mothers did stop lactating, they would be able to survive. They're already eating solid food. We've seen them ruminating already. Something we discussed with that baby giraffe as well, in terms of their ability to survive. And I think these little ones at this point would be fine. That's one of the reasons that they grow so incredibly rapidly, is to reduce the amount of pressure that they put on the females' bodies. So already that the females are pregnant for at least half of the year in producing these little lambs, and then they've still got to lactate for another month or for another extended period after that. So although these lambs are still drinking milk, if the environmental conditions get too stressful, then they will be able to stop lactating, and their babies will survive. And gentle grunts. The zebra have decided that they're brave enough to come and join us. Barbara's asked a wonderful question, and one that I'm going to enjoy answering. Barbara is watching in Potchefstroom in South Africa. Barbara, you were saying that it must be impossible to count impala, and how do you count them in terms of getting a bit of an estimate for reserve populations? You see that female calling there, the one that's just crossed the road. She's the one grunting like that. Barbara, there's a couple of methods. The most accurate and the most time-consuming in its own way, and certainly expensive, is to do helicopter counts. And there really are people who are absolutely brilliant at counting impala and things like that from the air. I've watched people do game counts from helicopters and actually even determine the sexes of the zebras they're looking at, which I have to tell you is no mean feat. Oh, a little bit of aggression there from those zebra. Not an easy job to do when you're looking at the animal from above, Those of you familiar with our drone shots will understand what I mean when I say that. Now imagine doing that from far higher. Ears back on that zebra. They're very unsettled about something. So Barbara, that's the most accurate way. You can actually take pictures of the larger herds and then count them from those, although that is very time consuming. And what I used to do in the research facility I used to work in was we did what was known as set routes. So you pick a sort of a cross section. You have different routes of the same length, of a known length, and you know roughly the area that you can see. And you drive one of those a week, and you count every single impala that you see. And you plug it into a mathematical formula, which I'm not going to go into great detail about and during this drive, but you plug it into a mathematical formula that allows to sort of roughly estimate the impala population that you have on a reserve. That's time consuming because you have to do it every week, but it does mean that you can actually change that formula in order to get population totals, for example, over summer, over winter, and it's a much sort of cheaper way of monitoring almost constantly. But it's a system that only really works in a smaller area or in a closed system, which is what I was in at the time. So I was on a 25,000 hectare reserve. This greater Kruger area is close to 3 million, a huge difference in size. But there are game count formulas and different methods that you can utilize to guess, roughly estimate how many impala there are. And once you get an accurate total, interestingly enough, there are really accurate averages as to how many or how the population increases each year. All coming dashing across the road. These zebra are behaving very strangely. Something's upset them. It could even be an encounter with a rival stallion that's got them as unsettled as they are, because the impala are not behaving in the same way. Impala behavior is fairly normal. Maybe they had a bit of an internal skirmish like the hyenas this morning. Does happen with zebra herds. Doesn't... go. Gilly, really good observation. You note your question came through just as I noticed that zebra that was standing at the back. Wait, come back here. Look at his tail quickly before he disappears off to the left. Don't wander away. We want to talk about your funny tail. So Gilly's noticed this shorter tail on the zebra and wants to know if there's a chance, because it's also got white hairs growing out of it as opposed to the long swishy black hairs of a normal zebra tail. And Gilly wants to know if there's a chance that it's been bitten off and then grown like that as an adaptation. Yes, I think that's exactly what's happened. Gilly, I don't think it's a birth defect. I think something happened where it was bitten. We've spoken a lot about that, and Gilly, as one of our regular viewers, will be familiar. But for new viewers, zebra can be incredibly aggressive to each other. And quite often you see them with missing tails. And most people assume when they first see that that's come from some lucky escape from something like a predator, a lion or a hyena, something along those lines. Yes, there you can see the normal tail of a zebra. But in actual fact, most of those injuries are caused by bites from other zebra. They've got incredibly powerful jaws and very sharp incisors. Goes wandering off. And I think, Gilly, that is that individual with the shortened tail and the white hairs growing out of it. I think that is what's happened. It's healed in a way that it would never grow back. What often happens is those bites crack the bones, the vertebra of the tail, and it gets to the point where bacterial infection actually means that the tips of the tails just drop off. And sometimes you see zebras without a tail at all, just a tiny, tiny stump. I'm gonna see if I can get you another view of them, but as I said, they're behaving very skittishly. Push a is a little bit too dense. Excuse me, Impala, have you seen any kudu hiding here? I wonder. Oh, zebras. Not going to be a bit tricky. Oh, there it goes. Valid question. So this morning during the hyena attack, I mentioned that the hyenas had sort of clustered around the back of the vehicle, and they definitely at certain points were touching it. So that poor hyena was searching for refuge underneath the cavity of the vehicle. Again, something absolutely fascinating about that sighting, the fact that that hyena was able to recognize and acknowledge the fact that, let's have a look, we've still got some impala there while I chat about this question. The fact that it was able to recognize that we were a possible safe option to help protect it is really truly incredible to me. And Jen B, you were wondering if maybe the zebra smell hyena blood on the vehicle. Yes, it's a possibility. I'm just trying to think, the wind, the problem is that we've been sitting downwind of them the entire time. Now we're sitting upwind of the Impala and there's been no reaction from them. Now I'm not certain where they, the two different species stand in terms of the sensitivity of their noses, but I don't think there's that much difference in their senses of smell. So I think the fact that they are comfortable with our presence maybe disproves that idea. Not a bad suggestion though, one I hadn't even thought about. I didn't even think about investigating the back of the vehicle actually after that happened, which maybe I should have done. I certainly think there would have been some blood transference. These impala look stunning in this light. You really get an idea of the shine that comes off their coats. As our little impala wander off, Barbara, with pleasure. I will explain to you the difference between male and female zebra. So Barbara's heard that their stripes determine whether it's a male or female, the stripe that runs between their bottoms, but you can't remember which way around it is. So the way I was taught to remember it is that male zebras wear G-strings or thongs, so the stripe is very thin between the cheeks of their bottoms in a somewhat unexpected way, and the female's stripe is much thicker and darker. Barbara, when I next see a zebra herd at some point this afternoon, which should happen, I'll try and stop, or maybe we can ask Steph if he sees them to give you a clearer demonstration, because it's actually not always that easy to see. Biologically, if you're wondering, it might make it easier for you to remember. The reason that the females have a thicker, darker stripe is actually because it's part of the genitals and it maintains that dark stripe. It's usually very, very difficult to see with zebra. Their testicles are particularly sort of tucked away and hidden, and you don't always see the penis. So that's the best way to have a look at the different gender between male and female. You can also see it in the behavior to an extent. So the male will always be almost always walk at the back of the herd, the female's ahead of him, so he takes that to protect the sort of the rear of the herd. That's his role as the strongest. He's also the most protective of the group. He'll usually put himself between his herd and any kind of a threat around it. That's another way that if you're sort of really struggling to see in the bushes, you might be able to guess at what his gender is. But our animals have moved off into the drainage lines and into the thick and dense vegetation around us. So we shall continue on our quest for interesting things to show you. Steph's man. managed to accomplish something that I have not, which is to get some Nyala on camera this afternoon. Let's pop over to him and see what those beautiful antelope are up to.
I promise you there's something alive behind that bush. It's a full-grown, in his prime, male Nyala. He's looking very beautiful. I'm just going to reposition a little bit so that I can show you why I say that he's in his prime. Most of these antelope species that have horns, we can see if they're in their prime or not by looking at the tips of their horns, the last inch. Have a look at the last inch of his horns where the white was. You saw there briefly when he stuck his head up that the two horn points are parallel to one another. There we go. Parallel to one another. That tells me that he is ready to fight and fight hard for females. If the points were pointing toward one another, he'd be immature, and if they were pointing away from one another, he'd be past his prime. So this is a prime bull Nyala, and he is magnificent. Have a look at him. Coat, face, body, all in very, very good condition. Standing side on to us. It has to be one of the most striking antelope that we find out here. Long shaggy coat, socks, beautiful horns, stripe, very pretty face. Once again, the ivory gleaming off the top of his horns as he's feeding there, catching my eye every time. Obviously a browser. And have a look at that ivory that VM's pulled onto right there. Have a look how sharp those horn tips are. Now, male Nyala will weigh anywhere up to 100 kilograms. You can imagine all 100 kilograms of him behind those points. Have a look at those lips nibbling on all the bushes. Very similar to that giraffe that we saw a little bit earlier. Nyala are also ruminants. Very successful way of eliciting food out of the bush. They use a system of fermentation in their guts, which allows them to break down plant cellulose, which is actually quite a difficult thing to do, to be quite honest. Plant cellulose is one of those substances very similar to keratin, where only very few specialized animals can actually. Now why he did that was because he came into the open. Oh, look at that screenshot, everybody, don't be shy. That was beautiful. Eric has just asked me probably the question of the day so far. Are those colored socks for camouflaging his feet in the grass? Eric, you know, it would seem apparent what those socks would be for. However, it is an enigma to me. I have a funny feeling it's probably got something to do with reproduction. Because otherwise kudu and bushbuck would share those common sock colors. I think it's just something to do with their coats that they have. It's just part of the reproduction selection that females have for Nyala. Giving it one last look at him. And that females just find Nyala with socks on sexier than males that didn't have socks on at some point. And now the Nyala is now obviously have moved away. Down into some thick bush. Quite common for them to be in thick bush. There's an airplane there. That is now a bird that you don't see so common over Juma, especially not this time of the day. That is how people get in and out of here when they don't drive. So that's one of these little bush aeroplanes that frequent the skies around the Sabi Sands. Absolutely not that common over Juma. And most people drive into Juma and Arethusa. Whereas in the south of the Sabi Sands, south and central of the Sabi Sands, most people fly in. I remember from my time spent in the south and the central part of the Sabi Sands, it used to drive me absolutely insane. The skies are just full of aeroplanes. Now that Nyala has moved off into some thick bush, some very thick bush. We won't be able to go in there. It's similar bush to what we're driving through right here. This road cuts through a thicket that is probably about 50 to 150 hectare big. Now, I'm quickly going to cut this down. There's a question coming through. I'll answer it in a sec. I just want to cut this off. We try not to drive around bushes like this simply because we just create more roads. You might think that that's being a little bit weird because of the fact that we go off-road, but roads are quite difficult here for us to rehabilitate, and so we'll try not to. As easy as that, and it gave me a bit of exercise in the process. So just plug myself back in. So back to the explanation why we don't just drive around. We try and limit the damage that we do to the bush here as much as what we can, to be quite honest. Jamie's got that pregnant kudu. We'll tell you a bit more about it in a bit.
Hey, wonderful news. We have found the kudu that I was looking for. She is hugely pregnant. I know it's her, and when I have an opportunity, I'll be able to show you why. But she's got a very distinctive stripe pattern on her right side, around the sort of the last stripe towards her bottom. Still no baby yet, but she is definitely looking really close. I would like to say that I tracked and found her, but actually this was pure luck. We've just been fortunate that they've been moving in a relatively small area on Juma. It's still been fascinating to spend as much time with this group as, or at least trying to find this group, as we have over the last few days. I'm gonna slowly inch forward. Didn't want to scare her off. Promise you she's the one we looked at that first afternoon that we said we're just so close to popping. And in fact, even her spine is starting to look prominent because that baby's hanging so low in her belly. There's another pregnant female off to my left here that I'm going to show you first. We accepted the challenge of trying to find you, or trying to get you a live kudu birth. I think it would be extraordinarily lucky if we did. But I'm not giving up hope. I'm gonna keep trying to follow these kudu until we see some youngsters wandering around with them. There's about three really pregnant cows. You can see this one's also bulging. And they're starting to swell. Their nipples are also swollen. If she would kindly oblige me, I don't think she's going to though. Hey, big girls, looking a little bit ungainly for a kudu. They're beautiful, slender shapes, looking a little bit distorted. And if you look really closely at whenever we stop at these pregnant females, you might even start to see the angles of the baby's joints sticking out. Don't see any on this female, but it's difficult in this light. one of my favorite times of year to be out in the bush, just because you get to see magical moments like this. I was going to tell you, oh yes, I remember now, for new viewers. So this is something I learned on the live safaris through a bit of research of my own. We know that little antelope babies are born ready to run straight away. And one of the viewers sent through a question a couple of weeks ago, a couple of months ago now, to ask how it is that those sharp little hooves don't do any damage to the female. So her fetus that she's carrying will have what's known as a deciduous hoof capsule, a soft, mushy layer that surrounds the hoof in utero so that they don't injure the female in any way. And as soon as they're born, those capsules start to wear away as soon as that baby takes its first steps. And of course, we know now from chatting about it regularly, the best time to witness a kudu birth or any kind of antelope birth is first thing in the morning. We witnessed that unbelievable moment where we saw the live wildebeest birth. Here's the little male that's part of this group. It's another reason why I know we're with the right group of kudu. He's quite distinctive with his tiny little horns poking up. And when I have a moment, when she's moved away a little bit, I'll be able to show you the kudu female that I was talking about and that distinctive stripe. But I promise you it's the same group. This time I know for certain. I love teenage kudu and Inyala. They've always got such gangly shapes to them. So we spoke a bit about the absence of elephants over the last 2 days or so, but we were surrounded by them a couple of days before that. And Pamela, you were wondering if there's competition between the elephants and the rest of the plant eaters or the rest of the herbivores. Elephants do occasionally chase them, but I'm not sure that's a competition thing. I think that they get irritable and they decide that they don't want little objects wandering around in their peripheral vision. So I've seen elephants chase impala before. It's one of those inexplicable aspects of animal personality that I can't quite explain. But in terms of competition, not really. They don't compete hugely. Now, interestingly, in times of drought, the elephants can actually be of huge assistance, or particularly after the winter season, so after the dry season. They actually help the herbivores. And the reason they do that is they go and they push over, especially around October, trees like knobthorns that are starting to get their new growth and the most nutritious leaves that sit at the top. So once an elephant has pushed over a tree, you'll sometimes find that the herds are being followed by especially animals like kudu that move behind them as a way of getting access to new growth that they otherwise might not be exposed to. Now, we keep chatting a bit about the drought, and I know sometimes for new viewers it might look a little bit strange because the trees look so green. You'll have to take our word for it when I say that the grass should be at least, in this area, should be at least stomach high on this kudu. It's really the grass layer that's suffering. The trees maintain their greenness, but their growth is going to stop fairly soon. The only reason they can maintain the green color that they have is because they've got underground root systems that can pull up moisture from underneath the surface of the soil. But those eventually dry up as well, and the plants can't rely on their reserves forever. So when we talk about the effects of the drought, it's hard to watch now. It will be 10 times harder in a couple of months after our dry season, when all of the trees have turned brown. He looks beautiful in that light, though. Obviously, I'm very, very reluctant to impact on them in any way, particularly because these females are so pregnant. I really hesitate to disturb them or make them move fast unless, unless it's completely accidental. So I don't want to drive right up close and disturb them, but I am going to move forward ever so slightly. Luckily, this herd is nice and relaxed, or has been nice and relaxed. Let the engine run for a little bit. Get them used to the idea. Let's see if I can show you that female I was talking about. So Pamela, the leaves start to change color around April or so. Will be when we really start to see the change. But the growth season stops in February, so it ends in February. The trees no longer really grow in any way. The grass doesn't grow much. So that's roughly when you can expect the change to happen. April, May is when the bush starts to go quite brown. Actually, I'm going to stop here. It's a little bit tricky to, I don't want to scare her. Oh, I didn't see you. Hello, boy. But they are nice and relaxed. You can see we're not impacting on their behavior. They're still feeding. There's a pregnant female missing. Not missing, but I haven't seen her. There were three pregnant cows when I first came across this group. I've only seen two at the moment. That doesn't mean she's not here. It means that I just haven't seen her. And I think this is the female I'm talking about. Is she? Can't tell. Her bottom's hidden. Look at her reaching up to try and get those leaves. Very nimble lips to work around the thorns and the spines of the trees out here. And the fact that I can't see the one pregnant cow could mean one of two things. One, she's still in the thick vegetation and she just hasn't come out yet. Or two, she's actually had her baby. I'm not sure which of the options it is. I've said before that kudu don't have set herd structures, but they do generally move about in the same groups, is what I've noticed from observation. But if she went off to have her baby, there's a chance that she's off on her own, away from the rest of the herd. Nibbling away. I said that I wanted to prove to you that it's the same female. Let me give it a little bit more time. Let's see if she walks forward, if it is her. Otherwise, she's moved off to the left, but I promise I did see her. Let's just see if she's going to be obliging. Come on, girl. Or are those leaves just too delicious? Still munching there. Is that going to be the last? Yep, there we go. Is she going to move? Oh, wrong kudu. I wasn't sure which female it was. Desperately trying to get you a view. I promise I saw her when I came in. She is there. She must be the kudu that moved off to the left. Okay, well, you get the idea. We're back with our kudu again. There may or may not have been a birth. We'll have to wait and find out. And while I make my way around these kudu without disturbing them, I'm going to send you back over to Steph.
I'm glad that you got to see that female kudu with Jamie. She absolutely obviously hasn't given birth yet, which is nice, but we'll keep on. I'm sure Jamie is very excited about seeing what happens to that baby, and I actually hope that she can share it with you. Now, I was in the process of telling you why we chopped that branch down. And basically, we just don't want to create too many paths here around different areas. We will create additional roads to hyena dens, as we have done to that hyena den. And we also create additional roads to things like static kills, large kills. One path in and one path out. And then when the kill moves on or when the den closes down, we'll go and rehabilitate that area. And we do that by brush packing the old paths with elephant damaged branches in an effort for grass to come up there again. So you don't have these unsightly paths all through the bush. And you can actually see in places like this, the benefit of that is that this road basically is the only sign of us being here in the bush. For the rest, the paths between the bushes are all overgrown and regrown again, even in a dry time like this is. And so I quite like it. I quite like the feeling it generates is that you're the first person down the road. The first person to drive through this bush, when that is absolutely not the case. The Sabi sand has been going for close on 60 years already. Many different things in its lifetime. That is a big male waterbuck. Now, for those of you who are watching a little bit earlier, and especially when we were talking about the Nyala, I was talking about horn points. Have a look at the tips, the last inch of the horn. You'll notice that they are pointing towards one another. This is an immature bull, even though he looks big. So he would not be ready for mating just yet. Immature bull waterbuck, weighing in at about 220 kilogram, not 400 pound for a big one. Big. And he's just standing in the shade there. He's a grazer, so he eats grass, as opposed to the Nyala that we were viewing a little bit earlier, only being a browser and eating leaves and twigs. Quite a common antelope here in the Sabi Sand. It's in actual fact the emblem of the Sabi Sand. Ah. And Pamela might have heard me referring to the top of the Nyala horns, of the white tips of the horns, as being ivory. Pamela, it's just a reference to the white tip of the horn. Kudu have it as well, and bushbuck. It's a common trait amongst the Tragalaphian antelope, the kudu, bushbuck, Nyala, bongo, and sitatunga. But it is not ivory. It's not made of enamel. That is what ivory is made of. It is made of keratin. It's actually closer related to rhino horn than it is to ivory, but is not in danger of being harvested. There's a misconception that rhino horn has these magical properties. It absolutely doesn't. If you want to know what rhino horn does for you, cut your fingernails and swallow them and see what effect it has on you. That's basically what rhino horn does for you. It's just keratin. It's just a large fingernail or conglomerate of hair, similar to what you're seeing on this waterbuck. His horns are also made of keratin around a bony sheath or bony core. Sorry, it's a keratin sheath around a bony core is what I actually meant to say. Has a blood supply, so it's not an antler. North America and in other parts of the world, you have antelope that have antlers. It's very, very cold in those areas, and animals can't have blood supply going to extremities with large surface areas, and so they shed their horns in winter in an effort to help them regulate their body temperature. Here in Africa, the temperatures or the ambient temperatures are relatively high, and here you can have a bony core, which allows you to have a much more robust horn and something that you can defend yourself with as well as fight for mates with. And waterbuck absolutely can defend themselves with those horns. They can inflict some terrible damage to each other. Have a look at those ridges. Those ridges are to stop the horns from sliding past one another easily, and it allows two combatants to wrestle one another, locking horns and using the pressure against those ridges to stop the horns from inflicting too serious injury. Obviously, they won't if there's a concerted attack. They'll push past those ridges, but generally they'll just wrestle with one another. Try all avenues except for deadly combat first. Now, for a long time, people have thought that you couldn't eat water buck, or that lion didn't like water buck because they've got a funny smell, they've got a funny taste. And while that is true, lions absolutely eat water buck. But what they do is they've got a lot of subcutaneous glands in their skin. It helps with the type of waterproofing. Water buck, as their name implies, are not shy of jumping into water to get away from predators. And to help them shed water off of their fur, away from their skin, their skin produces a lot of glands, the sebaceous glands, and that oily secretion that comes out of these glands actually has quite a rank smell. And if you were to skin a water buck, for instance, and squeeze these glands and their oily secretion there onto your hands and then touch the meat without washing, even if you washed it, it's quite a water-resistant oil, the meat would be tainted by this gland. I myself haven't tasted water buck. I haven't had the pleasure of tasting it. I also haven't had the pleasure of tasting water buck meat that's been tainted or untainted by this glandular secretion. But I am told that it's not a very nice taste. It tastes almost the same as it smells. And water buck, downwind of a water buck, you can actually smell them. They've got a very particular smell about them. We're going to move on from this water buck, see what else we can find. Myself and VM haven't seen a cat in so long.
I saw it yesterday.
VM saw a cat yesterday. That's what he's just informed me. I haven't. I'm beginning to doubt the fact that they even occur. Yeah, they definitely... I'm the worst person in the world to come and see cats with. I have anti-cat mojo. I get very sidetracked by insects and birds and bizarre plants. I don't do nearly enough kilometers to warrant finding a cat. I leave that up to sportsmen like Brent Leo Smith, who take it as a personal affront if he hasn't seen a cat, or at least had a part in finding a cat in a 24-hour period. Before a bird flies away, Jamie wants to show you. We'll go to here.
This beautiful eagle was actually having a bit of a drink and a bath in a puddle before I came around the corner and got a bit of a fright, retreating to a dead tree. It was Teb spotted it as it was having a bit of a swim, so it's ruffling its feathers. Really difficult for me to tell you. I would suspect it is a tawny eagle, just looking at the body posture and the shape and size of it. But obviously with a silhouette like that, it is really tricky. The other option is a steppe eagle, giving its beak a wipe after the bath. I suspect though it's a tawny eagle. Beautiful. Silhouetted against that dead tree. And I guess we don't always think about the impact that the drought has on the big birds of prey. It must be nice to go and cool off in the pool, so to speak. Now having a really sensible preen. And all the bird species, from big to small, are fastidious about their hygiene. Their feathers are always kept neat, clean, and in place. And that's essential because their feathers are their livelihood. It's how they fly. So it's really, really important they stop them from getting coated in anything from mud to sand to parasites. So a quick bath can often be very helpful. It's also a really good way to cool down. And what we've noticed over the last few weeks is that the swimming pool at the house that I live in, the kingfishers come by every single day to come and have a bath. And it's not necessary. At first I thought they were dipping down to pull insects out of the pool, but in fact it's not that at all. They're dipping in to cool down. So birds don't just pant, they also swim to cool down. master of all it surveys. Well, that's the impression it gives off anyway. It always looks so dignified, staring out across the bushveld. Against that dramatic background, oh, a little hop there. I just said you were dignified, dancing for us. That's very precarious, that particular tree. Looks like it's, that branch looks like it's about to go. It really does. You can see it bobbing about. And I mean, that bird doesn't weigh very much. That tawny eagle, probably somewhere under 3 or so kilograms. So less than 7 pounds. But it still looks as though that branch is a little bit of a precarious perch to have chosen. That limb that's extending out is essentially dead bark at this point. Never seen an eagle fall out of a tree before. Wow, look at that dramatic sky. I would hope it was bringing more rain, but unfortunately I think that's the end of the front. Maybe I'm wrong. I hope I'm wrong. Look at that view. As Jerry might say, sometimes Africa provides pictures so beautiful they look as though they were painted. Stunning. I was hoping that if I sat here nice and still and peaceful, our beautiful tawny eagle might decide to come and resume its bath, but I think that it's decided that it would rather wait until we depart. Stunning. He was having, this eagle was having a bath in a natural mud puddle. It's not a puddle, it's a puddle. He was having a bath in the mud puddle, but I mentioned that the kingfishers have been dunking into themselves into the pool, and Mimi, you were concerned that the chlorine might hurt the bird in some way. Not in the levels and the concentrations that they're at. It hasn't had any negative impact on them. They've been dipping into that swimming pool. I will also say that the swimming pool is not bright sparkly blue at the moment. I have neglected it, so it's a little bit green and sort of more natural than it might otherwise have been. But Mimi, no, they are fine with that. And I also think that their senses of smell are strong enough that even if there was to be a dangerous concentration of chlorine, they would actually smell that and avoid it. So their sense of survival is actually fairly strong. They wouldn't, I don't think they would dunk themselves in water that was going to do them any kind of harm. And I can assure you that the frogs that I pull out on a regular basis are also unharmed from their experience. And since we're here, I'll just show you the mud puddle that he was having a swim in. So nice to see groundwater again. It really, really is. You know what he might also have been doing, although I think it's unlikely. Pretty sure he was swimming. Just by the way he was ruffling his feathers afterwards. Might have been after terrapins in the puddle. But I do think that's unlikely. Terrapins are not really all that favored by predators unless they absolutely have to, just because they exude such smelly substances. But that's where he was having a swim. And behind that, the backdrop of the Drakensberg Mountains. And the end, I think, I hope I'm wrong, but I think the end of that weather front that brought us the much needed rain. And those mountains keep on catching the rain and clouds and keeping them there. The end point of 1,000 kilometers worth of mountain range, the Drakensberg Mountains, the Mountains of the Dragon. And it sort of does look like it was raining there. It seems to always happen that they catch the best part of the rain. And when I drove through the mountains earlier on my way back to work, coming from Johannesburg, I noticed that the mountains were looking beautifully green. Deceptively so, because it's not just the Sabi Sands that's struggling in the drought. The rest of the country is as well. All right, well, it's always nice to stop for a moment, even with the frenetic pace of the live safaris, and just enjoy a moment to look at the stunning scenery that this place provides us with. Let us continue onwards. For those of you who are planning a visit to South Africa, I would highly recommend paying a visit to the Drakensberg Mountains at some point in your trip if you can. They provide for some of the most breathtaking scenery I have ever seen anywhere in the world. And the amazing thing about them is that the colors are never the same. Ah, just seen a gentleman who could well be a future father, whether he realizes it or not. I'm gonna be very obliging though, not nearly as obliging as the ladies were. I'm talking about a magnificent kudu bull. Hello, boy. Here you go. See him? Hiding behind the leaves? Yeah, look at him. We know this gentleman. We've seen him before. Tightly coiled horns. And somehow beautifully clear white stripes. Look at him ducking his head back to move through the dense vegetation. Stately. I said that he was probably a future father. That's complete guesswork on my part. I have absolutely no idea. I'm going to get you a peer review if he decides to cooperate. Sort of. But that being said, a male of this size would be the sort of kudu bull that would have mating opportunities out here. He's one of the largest kudu bulls that we see on Juma, along with the famous Zeus. Disappearing off with what can only be described as absolute dignity. And certainly far more grace than I've ever achieved walking through the bush. I usually stumble my way over termite mounds. He stepped over it without even looking. Making my way along the western edge of Juma. I'm planning on making my way towards the Mbuba Road Hyena Den. I'm just waiting for the temperature to cool down a little bit and for it to get a little bit darker before I do. Ooh, nice. Animal I haven't seen for a couple of days. If they decide to be good and break the pattern of the afternoon. Hello, warthogs. You've been wallowing. You can see they've spent their afternoon lying in mud puddles. Oh, shiny and covered in wet mud. Foraging around a fallen tree. I wonder if there's some nice vegetation that's been sheltered there. Possibly some shoots that have been protected by fallen bits of bark and rotting wood. Makes sense in my head that that would be the case. All wandering about on their ankles as they forage. Oh, and behind them, a brief blur of impala males being silly. They're still exhibiting that behavior. Steph's got a bird to show you and it might fly away. Let's go over there.
Have a look at that sight. Have a look at that sight. Three battalier eagles in one tree. Isn't that fantastic? And what makes it even more remarkable, as far as I can see, they are all three adults. I'm gonna
still with our warthogs. We've stopped to have a brief rub on the log, a brief scratch. I remember it was one of the first things I was ever tested on in a tracking exam, was a warthog rubbing post along a termite mound. I'm trying to work out whether I should go forwards or backwards to get you another clear view. Backwards is the way forward, so to speak. Forwards is the way forwards. I don't think we're going to get another view. Oh no, we are. We are indeed. Three little pigs in a row. All foraging on their elbows. We had a brief period where a warthog family moved onto Philemon's cut line. There's a female and a couple of youngsters. And we're very close to that area that they moved into. I'm not sure if this is them though. I don't think so. I think this is a different group of warthog. If it is them, then there's definitely been a decrease in population. It's impossible to tell with the warthog around here. This is actually, for new viewers, this is a rare treat to be able to sit and watch warthog. They tend to be exceptionally skittish in this area. Sorry guys, just listening to the Game Drive channel quickly. Sounds as though the Nkuhumas have made it back onto Buffleshoek as well as the Telemates. So they had disappeared into Kruger for a while, but it sounds as though they've come back and that Junior is with them. So for those of you who have been wondering about the Nkuhumas and the fate of the young male lion that is with them, he's still with them by the sounds of things. Our warties are disappearing and Steph has found you another view of those battaliers. So let's pop over there.
Please excuse us for these technical gremlins. One of these areas where we just don't seem to have perfect signal and we lost you there for a second. But have a look at these three eagles. And I can now confirm that they are three full-grown battalier eagles, 3 full-grown Battelier eagles. That is quite a rare sight to see sitting in the tree, to be quite honest. Now, my immediate question I'm asking myself is there a killer round? I don't think so. These eagles are busy preening one another. They're not looking intently at the ground at all. And I'm actually just wondering if this is a bit of a courtship display going on. The eagle at the top is a male, and I know that because his wing covers on the outside are completely black. He's also smaller than the eagle at the bottom in the foreground, which is a female. And the reason why eagles, the females are a little bit bigger, is because they lay the eggs. They need a bigger body to draw all the energy from to lay the eggs that they do. So eagles, in most birds in actual fact, the female is slightly larger than the male. Particularly you see that in eagles. But have a look at that. That is a rare sight. The one behind the one on the branches at the bottom, I can't see whether it's a male or a female. I think they're two females. My mind whether or not these eagles are related, the two bottom ones. It's mom, dad, and then a sub-adult, which has now just got their adult plumage. Depending on the book that you read. And they get their adult plumage at about 9 years old, as far as I know. I will double check. Let me double check here quickly. It's not in the book that I have here. I have a plethora of books next to me here which help me answer the more difficult of the questions. And exactly when a Battelier baby gets its full-grown plumage, I will try and answer myself. Otherwise, what I can do is just put it to you. With you having access to all the information resources you do at your fingertips, I'm sure you'd be able to find it pretty quickly. I want to say 9 years old. You're welcome, please, to send your answers to the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or email questions@wildearth.tv with your answers, and I'll gladly share the answer with all of the rest of our viewers. The two books I have on birds don't have it listed. One after another, so that was the male that left after a female, and now the other one goes as well. All right. Let's see if they... I do know there's a nest in that area. They didn't fly off. They actually just flew into a very squeaky nest. Let me go.
For losing Steph again. He's just having a couple of problems this afternoon with Rusty's signal. Never fear, I'm sure he'll be back with you in just a few moments, but he has moved on from those Battelier's, and I think just the movement was a little bit too much for Rusty's signal this afternoon. Tebs and myself are making our way across towards Impala Plains to see what action is happening there. I know that whenever I have Tebs on board with me, we've practically doubled our chance of spotting leopards. Tebs seems to be a lucky charm in that particular respect. I think his first 2 weeks here largely were spent driving with me, hey Tebs?
Yeah.
And we had leopards pretty much every day. I'm not sure what it is about Tebs, but he's got a special gift in that respect. A quiet chuckle, and not because, and I have to share this with you, I'm not sure the director's going to be very impressed with me. But Jerry was just feeding me through a question from one of our viewers. I'm not laughing at the question at all. Laughing at poor old Jerry trying to get the sentence out. And it wasn't quite working. Okay, controlling myself. Okay, deep breaths. All right, so... travel tips. Jerry, that's how you say it. It's travel tips. I don't know. I can't really talk. So one of our anonymous viewers who wants to remain anonymous would like to know if I have any travel tips for a lady traveling alone to South Africa. And she'll be coming in the future and will be traveling alone and would like to know. She doesn't really want to announce that she'll be traveling on her own. It depends very much on where it is you would like to be going or where you will be, but for the most part, please don't stress too much about it. I know that in certain respects there's a lot of a reputation about South Africa as being incredibly dangerous, but it's about having common sense in the way that you approach it. So if you, for example, start your trip off in Johannesburg, make sure that you just double check that the transport companies that you're going to use, afternoon hornbills, but the transport companies you use within Johannesburg are reliable. I'd actually recommend using just one of the most reputable taxi companies if you have to. The Gautrain is perfectly safe, and be aware of it. Don't wander around on your own at night through the city, but you can go and visit the various hotspots. I definitely recommend, depending on where you're going, getting a travel guide. Once you hit the low veld, it's absolutely wonderful. And I'll tell you straight up that as I've traveled as a woman alone throughout all of the rural areas within Limpopo and Mpumalanga, or a lot of the rural areas, and I've only ever found people to be incredibly friendly and helpful, and I've never felt threatened. I wouldn't travel through certain villages in the middle of the night on my own. But for the most part, you will be absolutely fine. Again, it's difficult for me to answer specifically because I don't know exactly where it is you're going. But just get a little bit of advice from the areas that you're in. Have a look at some of the travel guides. Where are we in the year? We're in January. I should know that, but you'd be surprised how you lose track. So you're coming at a really stunning time to be visiting South Africa over the next few months. The temperatures are going to start to cool down ever so slightly, so you're not in danger of overheating. And at least we've had a little bit more rainfall. What other travel tips? I'm trying to think quickly. It's just really about being sensible about what you do. I have lost handbags before, filled with passports and phones. I've left my wallet somewhere before, and every time they've been safely returned to me. But just be aware of that. Be sensible in where you go. Keep an eye on your possessions. Don't leave them hanging on a chair at a restaurant or something like that. But beyond that, I also think that you'll find, particularly if you're staying in hostels or something along those lines, maybe backpackers, you'll find plenty of friendly people about to make friends with. Lots of fellow travelers making their way to South Africa. I wondered where you lot were. This is where you've been hiding. So wildebeest herd. Oh, goodness, you're everywhere. I was going to move forward to get you a nice clear view, but there's a little calf in the way. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. All 10 here. All 10 present and accounted for. I think I'm going to have to stop here, otherwise I'm going to disturb them. Look who's steeping on the side of the road there. Hello, babies. So this is where our wildebeest herd has gone to. It's been a whole 24 hours since I last saw them. Look at the horns. This is the first time I've noticed them. I think I'm a bit behind the times. You guys probably have seen them already. That's amazing. a month into life and already growing horns. So cool to see. Here's the rest of them. A pile of wildebeest calves. With those tiny little stumps poking up. I wonder if it feels a bit like teething to them. I wonder if it sort of gets that itchy sore feeling when they start to poke through. I bet it does. I bet it must feel really strange. I wonder if they get really proud of themselves as well when they start to grow horns. Very cute. I'm not sure if any of you guys have noticed them already. This is the first time I've been able to pay close enough attention to their heads. So incredible to think that just a month ago, we were watching these little creatures stumble into the world. And those horns, for those of you unfamiliar with antelope anatomy, oh, did you hear that? There's a black-bellied bustard somewhere here. Listen for the call that sort of goes whoop, and then a champagne cork popping at the end. I'll try and go quiet when it happens again. But I was chatting about antelope horns, and they are bone. So that's bones growing up out of their head that we're looking at, covered by a keratin sheath. We've got these two lying down, but Tebs, if we can look at the little one that's standing up at the right on the road there. It's much smaller than the others, in my opinion. Maybe it's just because it's further away, but it doesn't look like it. It really looks smaller in size. Looks a little bit more unsteady. Still got horns. Oh, thanks. There's the bustard again. I'm sure if we were able to push past these wildebeest, we'd see it. Maybe we get lucky and it walks in front of us. I love that bustard. It's always around this road. But yes, that little wildebeest must have been born a bit later than the others. Definitely looks a bit smaller and slightly less developed. It's also darker in color still. And apparently, possibly constipated as well. Having a bit of a struggle there. I'm glad we managed to catch up with these guys and that all 10 calves are accounted for. The females are all looking perfectly healthy as well. Here's the bustard calling again. Oh, I really want to be able to show you it while it calls. It's one of my favorite things to witness. They are so comical. They have a way of stretching out their neck and then retracting it that is highly entertaining to watch. The last time we saw this bustard on this road, Brian imitated its call and it called back in response. So if we do get a chance to see it, I will definitely try and have a go. I don't think I'm nearly as talented as Brian is at imitating. Look, that one's starting to get the black face. It's the first place that they go dark, and that must be one of the oldest calves. With its little horns. Even the mane has started to go dark on that one. Must be one of our first babies. And look at that, already ruminating. We've chatted about that before with the impala lambs. But they're already at the point where solid food is second nature, and they can stop and rest and ruminate quietly on the day. I wonder if there's aspects of wildebeest behavior that we don't know. I wonder if that female is acting as a babysitter to this little nursery. She's been with them the whole time that I've been sitting here. Shame. And it's exhausting work, growing that fast. Need plenty of time to rest. Just like growing teenagers, actually. Awesome to catch up with them. And I believe that Steph has a slightly bigger baby to show you.
Just when we thought I couldn't find anything, out of the bush pops this tiny little elephant herd. There must only be about 7 or 8 elephants in this herd. And I think we're with the matriarch. The matriarch's over my head there. Let me just get out of the way. I haven't seen another elephant that's as old or as large as what she is. Got a beautiful body. Nice deep belly. And the wind that's blowing from her to us has just filled the air with this herby smell. Is herbal toothpaste is what their breath smells like. She's now moved up. As I was saying, she exhaled straight into our car, and one of the things that it reminded me of quite strongly, elephant breath smells like herby toothpaste, and has this real awesome smell to it. Something that once smelt, you'll never forget. These two youngsters, they're busy picking at some grass. Together, I think they're having a little bit of a game of who can pick the grass the quickest. Around about the same age, their tusks are just erupting from their jaws, so they're just over a year old now, both of them. Well, one is just over a year old, one is just under a year old. Still being weaned. And we've got another Ellie that's coming right up here, another youngster. See this one. Probably come and give us a bit of a sniff. Hello. Hi. That's okay. Isn't that wonderful? Oh, the big guy. Very good condition. Mom is looking after him quite nicely. Young male. I love elephant. To me, they represent everything about Africa. They are tragic, they are scary, they are huge, they seem unbreakable and unfazed by anything. These two having a wrestle with one another. It's like two teenagers to be pushing one another around. I'm kind of a bit out of view. I'm sure they'll come back into it now. And here we got one of their cousins coming in. All the elephants in this herd will be related with one another. It'll be hit up by the... It'll be head up by the strongest cow elephant, which is not necessarily the oldest. It is most of the time the oldest, but not necessarily the oldest. It's the strongest cow elephant at the time. We've got some more elephant coming up behind us, I'm sure. I'm just going to start my car quickly. can't switch it off, just to make sure that the vehicle does start. What you don't want to do is, these elephants, I didn't even know they were there. What you don't want to do with the elephant is be caught in the middle of a herd without a forward escape route. I'm always very, very careful about having a forward escape route and making sure that my car can start. As you can see, you hardly ever really need to use it. Even though that elephant was literally 2 feet in front of our vehicle, he posed no threat. What we do is learn how to read, or you, as a field guide, you learn how to read elephant behavior very quickly. And that elephant wasn't posing us any significant risk. As a field guide, sorry about us going black screen, we are parked right on the periphery of a weak signal area. And from time to time, I think it's as the wind blows, the signal comes in and blows in and blows out. Now, what I was saying is that very quickly as a field guide, you learn how to read elephant behavior. It's a necessity. And you only really realize how little you know once you've had your first really big scare. And elephants are easily more scary than lion, easily. Also more deadly than what lion are as well. So I always make sure that I've got a forward escape route. So I always make sure that my vehicle can work. And I'm always watching the oldest cow. She's the one that's gonna dictate what the herd does. This particular case, we've got an elephant coming now behind us. She's got a young baby. Obviously, she's gonna be quite protective of that youngster, but we're not between her and her baby whatsoever. And we are facing away from her, so I don't think we're going to have any trouble. Nevertheless, to be blasé around elephant is to invite disaster. Isn't she wonderful? She's obviously still nursing. You can see her big swollen mammary glands between her front legs. This youngster's a couple of months old. Not quite understanding what we are. Country West has just made a comment that this might be the best looking or best conditioned herd that you've seen in a while. And I must agree with you, Country West. I also think that these elephants are in fantastic condition. And I'm not quite sure why, to be quite honest. It's been so dry, there's not grass around, there's not a lot of grass around. And unless they've moved in from a different area, which is quite possible. I know of a radio collared elephant that moved 80 kilometers in one day here in the Kruger National Park. Distances that are only really attributed to elephant in dry, very dry places like in the Namib, where it's common for elephant to walk up to 50, 60 kilometers in a night for water. I know of an elephant that walked one day 80 kilometers from Skukuza all the way to Chokwan in one day, in a 24-hour period, which is a considerable distance. We do have an elephant literally right here at VMsdale. I can show you how close she is to us. It's the mother of that calf that just walked past us. Just give you an idea, there's just one bush between us and this elephant, how camouflaged they actually are. I'm going to get to Wendy's question about how soon after birth forehead profiles between male and female are observable. In a quick second, the end of this elephant's tusk is notched. There, VM is just showing it to you through the shrub there. She would use... Seems like when we zoom... She would use that notch on her tusk as a tool when she's feeding, and she'd favor the right side. There you go, she's favoring that right side there. You can see her using that notch in her tusk there. It's a great effect. The tusk with a notch on would be called her slave tusk. And over the years, she's actually worn a groove in the end of her tusk, and she's used it to probably wrench and cut vegetation to put bite-sized morsels into her mouth. I just find that absolutely incredible. There, she's just used it again. That was quite cool. All right, now back to Wendy's question about when it becomes visible that we can see forehead profiles between male and female elephant. From very soon after birth, I would say a couple of months, let's say 6 months, between 6 months and 1 year, you can start to see the female's forehead profile is quite angled. A male forehead profile is quite rounded. And I'll see if I can move around this herd. We're going to go out here now and go around the herd and see if I can show you a female forehead profile. I'm going to be going uphill because that's away from the bad signal area down there in the dip. And my brain is telling me if we can carry on going up, the signal will get better and better and we won't lose you as often in these black screens. Watching that female, she's got her tail cocked at us. You can see it's cocked to the one side. She's now swinging it, but you will notice as I drive forward that she holds up her tail to the one side. Because she's actually done that, I'm actually not going to be driving past her this way around. She's let me know very subtly that she doesn't want me to approach her from behind. And I fully respect that. She's weighing 3,500 kilograms. Signal seems a bit stable, which means that I can speak to you without fear of breaking up, and I can carry on telling you why I went on such a circuitous route around that tree. And it's because that female cocked her tail to the one side, which is a sure sign that she was upset with me. But have a look at this male, have a look at his forehead when he presents his profile to us again, and you'll notice that it's very round. It is a male, typically male. He's a youngster, and we're going to see some of the youngsters coming through the bush off to our right as well. Sorry, VM. These Ellies have got there. It's another young bull, and that's one of the youngsters. You can see he also had a very rounded forehead profile. As opposed to the females that are very angular. Now, of course, I've parked in a place where moments before there were 10 elephants, and now they're nothing. We're just gonna have to reposition again. It's pretty typical of trying to keep up with elephants in the bush. They feed, they move on, they feed and they move on, and they disappear very quickly. Thank you. go around this big termite mound. Get into a slightly more forward position where the elephants are moving towards us. And hopefully I'll be able to finish my explanation as to their forehead profiles and how you sex them. So now, I don't want to get ourselves into a sticky situation here with an elephant that is, watch out for this thorn bush over here, we'll grab you out of the car. Thread my way through here. Looks good here again, so I'm trying to thread my way through to chase away any of these elephants or make them unduly stressed. What I'm going to try and do is park somewhere where we've got elephant on both sides of us, where I can show you that forehead profile. That is that this elephant the picture like that. So much as mentioned, we are traveling right on the periphery of a poor signal area, and as I'm moving in and out and the signals come in and going, we're losing and getting enough. When I was VM, oh hold on, let's see what this one's profile looks like. It's quite difficult to sex this one using the profile because she's got her head up, or he's got her head up. But there are some elephant coming from the front there, Viam. And we've got a young bull in the front with his very domed forehead. And then behind him, we have a female with a very angular forehead. And that's about the best example that I can give you. The one domed forehead and one angular forehead of a female African elephant. That was quite nice actually. Dorothy has just asked, how can you tell the age of an elephant? Now Dorothy, it just comes with experience in most cases using external signs. But the only real way to tell an elephant's age is by opening up the mouth and seeing which molar the elephant is on. Elephants get 6 sets of molars in their life, and they get them at roughly within rough ranges from one another, diet depending of course. So the more rougher the diet of an elephant, the quicker they wear their molars out. But even so, the elephants still get their molars at set ranges in their life, and you'll be able to give an approximation by opening up the mouth and having a look. And of course the only way to get an elephant to open up their mouth, the wild African elephant here, is to dart one using a vet, and they're quite good at sexing at aging elephants, at least anyway. The last set of molars come in at about 45 years old and will last that elephant until they die at, in this area, between 55 and about 65 years old. You wouldn't say that there are 10 elephants right in the bush around us, would you? Nice and not quiet, but they are just, they're everywhere. Every bush that I'm of some kind of it. But a bit of a tussle. You can see how those bulls use their forward-facing tusks to effect to stab one another. That's how they'd wrestle, even when they are adults. That was just a adolescent wrestle, wasn't anything serious. Fanning their ears to keep themselves cool. And Anna's asked a nice question. Can an elephant survive if it loses its trunk to a predator? Only three things can be fatal to an elephant, Anna. Loss of their use of their trunk, the loss of their feet, and the loss of their ears. And so, yes, an elephant cannot survive if it loses the use of its trunk. And it can use the loose, what a tongue twister. It can lose the use of its tongue through a disease called floppy trunk disease. Elephant get that. It can also lose the use of its trunk through injury, either from fighting, from lions, as you've quite rightly said, or through an injury, a branch hurting it, or tusk. Fire can also damage it, snares can damage it, they can be bitten off as youngsters, so elephant can bite each other's trunks off. And their feet and their ears are generally lost either through snares, in terms of their feet, for most animals out here. Alright, so just to recap on that. So snares, I've seen elephant lose their feet through snares, but mainly in the wild, they'll lose their feet through feet and ears get damaged in fires quite a lot. So three things that can kill an elephant if they lose it is their ears and their feet and their trunk. If they lose the use of any of those things, it's mortal to an elephant, unfortunately. Having said that though, I've seen thousands upon thousands, perhaps even tens of thousands of elephants. And the amount of elephant that I've seen without the use of their trunk or with their ears burnt off and their feet have burnt off, number less than five in all of those. So it's not a very common thing to see whatsoever. So don't get yourselves too upset about this happening. It's very, very rare. It's a rare occurrence for elephant to lose the use of any of these appendages. Forward a little bit and just change our angle a bit again. Boisterous youngsters. And while we're busy repositioning, I've just been told that Jamie has arrived at the hyenas.
We've made our way to the hyena den. I wonder what that go away bird's shouting at. Sorry, distraction for a moment. It's just him though, so I think it's just calling to announce the beginning of the evening. We found what looks like to me Bella and June. Yes, that's, I'm pretty sure that's Bella. You can see how much fluffier June is. Right, so a little bit more on the recap of this morning. What's been interesting about that, so the hyena on the right, her mother is the one that we, or his mother, sorry, we suspect it's a male, is the one that we suspect is the matriarch of this clan, and has followed in the two situations where we saw her, him, oh goodness, I used to have a fully functioning brain once, believe it or not, let's try that again. The last two fights, so the one we saw this morning and the really serious one, that some of the viewers may have witnessed with Scott. That little one has followed on after the injured hyena. And I'd be really, it's really interesting behavior to have observed because it's obviously curious about the goings on and the happenings whenever something like that occurs. Somebody's calling at the den. Can hear the contact calls to the cubs. And I was stopped from approaching the den by the presence of these two sub-adults. Actually, I would not go so far as to call this little one a sub-adult, still a cub at this point, to me, but only just. Now, June's mother is a big hyena, a big female, with a deep scar on her back. Now, I'm still trying to figure out where she fits in this hierarchy, because I've always thought that, or I always thought, from how she behaved, that she was the matriarch, but I got that wrong. She isn't the matriarch, as far as I can tell, from what we learned this morning. We've got a couple of scars there. We suspect that this little one is a male, fairly certain that he is. And interestingly, hyenas, it's really only the males of the matriarchs that really get to show any kind of description of dominance within the clan. And that's because they've inherited something of their mother's status. Even then, they're still subordinate to most females, but it's the only time that you'll see males start to show a little bit of dominance. We suspect, I'm going to transport viewers back to 6 months ago, which is the only time that I can start speaking from experience, when I started working here last year, July. And we started out with this little one that was tiny, tiny still, still brown without spots. And there was Bella at the den as well still, and there was twins. There were two hyenas, siblings, that were in between June's age and Bella's age. We suspect, and I find it difficult to actually confirm personally, although I think that the the information given by a couple of our viewers is correct. I suspect it's correct, is the fact that the hyena that was attacked today was the mother of that set of twins. We never gave her a name, and it was very difficult to compare spot patterns because this morning she was covered in blood and dirt. But I do agree, I think it was the mother of the twins. She was always subservient in the sightings that we had at the Filaments Cutline Den. I think that might have been the hyena we saw disciplined today. Having a bit of a doze off to the side. June's exploring its world. I'm still uncertain in my own mind as to June's sex. I always thought she was a female, just by the boldness that she exhibited, or it exhibited. But I haven't confirmed that personally. Looking a little bit thin, actually. I wonder if that's because of the extended absence of her mom. I'm going to finish off my summary for the hyena den for now, just because at the moment we're blocked from visiting the den by the presence of these two little ones. I don't want to startle them. In the meantime, Steph is still with his elephants, so let's head over there.
We finally managed to catch up with these elephants on the other side of this thicket. And this female is doing something that I quite often see signs of in the bush, but it's quite rare to actually see them doing it. And she's busy moving sticks out of the way to get to plant material. They are keystone species. They are species that are absolutely essential to the health of an ecosystem. And when we see elephant knocking down trees, and that's what they do, and we see it as destructive, in actual fact, knock down trees, in particular these thorn trees like the knobthorn that she's busy, or the knobthorn thicket that she's busy feeding in now, offer and harbor protection for so many other organisms and plants when they're down. So the thorns effectively become an impenetrable barrier. They also act as a very effective windbreak, and seeds carried on the breeze get stuck in these thorny barriers and then germinate safely away from other herbivores. But this female knows that, and what she's done is she's then lifted up those branches and is in so uncovered a treasure trove of vegetation. And it might actually be why they look so healthy, is that they are led by a very clever female. She's got a beautiful body, that female. She looks like she's carrying a baby because she's quite heavy at the bottom towards the back. I would say she's pregnant. However, her calf doesn't look like he's old enough yet for mom to be pregnant again. The calf is coming out of the bushes now on our right-hand side and will join her. So she might just be full. She might just be one of these big-bodied females that we see quite often. I mean, not often. You see them quite rarely, but here in the Kruger National Park, you definitely get to see them from time to time. It's these really big-bodied females, and she's one of them. Move out of the way, you can see her youngster. He's only just over a year old. Tusks are just beginning to erupt from his mouth. And Fiona, out of the UK, has just wanted to know what causes the flappy trunk syndrome that I was talking about. Fiona, as far as I know, it's a disease. I don't know whether it's viral or bacterial. I want to say it's viral. It's a viral disease that affects elephants and gives them a floppy trunk. However, the last time I did any research on floppy trunk syndrome was probably about 15 years ago, and I can't actually remember whether it's viral or bacterial. I think it's viral. And is also isolated to only a few population of elephants. It's not something common amongst all elephant. It's just something elephant can get in some places. Now this elephant's got a wet patch just behind his eye. And that wet patch is a glandular secretion. Elephants have a gland, a preorbital gland. When they are stressed, so then rather than the preorbital gland that sits between the ear and the nose, or the eye and the nose, excuse me, and male elephant and elephant in general have secretions from this gland when they're a bit stressed. And I can only imagine that this baby is feeling a little bit stressed. You probably find mom stopped weaning, stopped giving him as much milk, and he's now having to fend for himself, and he's not quite getting enough vegetation. On top of all of that, walking to water the last couple of weeks has been a stressful affair. But it might also just be he's suffering from a cold, flu, his system's a bit down. Those glands are not always an indication of massive stress. It's just an indication of stress. And I'm sure almost all of you that are out there listening to me today would empathize with that. We all feel stressed from time to time. Not necessarily from anything too serious. Shaza has asked me, what are the causes for elephant to bite, and can they draw blood? And the answer to that is absolutely. They can even kill one another. Shaza, elephants fighting is a titanic battle, and they can absolutely cause massive injury to one another. I have seen a male elephant with a tusk mark in his neck round about here that I stuck my entire wound to stop it to
you. Well, from what I can see here, we do apologize again for Steph's sudden disappearances this afternoon as his signal comes and goes. But from what I can see here, this is pretty in the front. Behind her, believe it or not, there is another hyena. Corky, I think. Yes, I'm fairly certain it was Corky. She lifted her head earlier and she had that notch in her left ear. So Corky living up to her name and corking up the main entrance to the den. I haven't seen any sign of the cubs, but I think that's just because they're currently resting inside the hole. Now, there is another hyena, and I'm going to move forward while we can, since there's no cubs have popped their heads out yet. Let's go forward a bit. There's another hyena at the other entrance. Oh, hold on. Hold on, this changes things. Is that a tail or a cub? That's a cub. Okay, so that must be pretty, surely, unless we've got a third set of cubs here, because that's a suckling cub. A very tiny foot just made an appearance. And do we maybe, just a bit hard to tell at the moment, do we have more than two sets of cubs at this den? That's speculation. I'm actually not going to speculate just yet. Let's just see who this turns out to be. That cub looks like it has a very tiny bottom. Could it be? James was insistent about it. He was convinced that there was a female with a... Oh, that looks very tiny to me. And it's not porky. I'm going to go forward a fraction so that that branch isn't in the way. That's a very tiny foot. I think we've got a new baby. I think. Yep. That looks like... Well, maybe not. It's so hard to tell. We're going to have to wait a moment before I get ahead of myself and overexcited. Let's just wait to see and confirm. It's definitely not corky, which means it could be pretty. I might have got the ID wrong on the hyena that was lying up with Corky at the entrance to the den. The little foot looks so tiny, but I can't tell. I think looks like pretty now, looking at her face. And I think I see spots on the bottom of that cub. So I might have got ahead of myself there. Just looks like such a tidy foot. But I think that's November's foot. Oh, we've got to be patient. Nah, I think that's pretty. Sorry, got the ID wrong on the other individual that was lying down, in which case I have no idea who she is. I'll have to wait until she gets up. So the one lying down in front there is not pretty. Can you turn your ears forward for us, girl? Please? Just twitch your ears so I can see who you are. Doesn't really look like the big female that we saw this morning at the den. That's November. Charlotte, I hope you're getting excited about your guides training that you're going to be doing soon. Charlotte, you said you asked earlier because I spoke about an interloper. You were wondering what I meant by that. Hello. Sorry, Charlotte. You've got to have eyes in the back of your head at a hyena den. Didn't even see that little one approaching. Charlotte, when I was talking about an interloper, I can't remember exactly what I said, but I think I was saying that it was an internal disagreement. It wasn't an interloper that had entered into the fight. What I meant by that was a hyena that was not part of this clan. So somebody from the outside, an external hyena. Usually that would be a male. An interloper would be a male coming in and looking for mating opportunities. And in fact, I read a statistic today that said 97% of all matings within a hyena clan were with interlopers or nomadic males. So you do get clan males and natal males, but they only make up 3% in this particular study that was done of the males that mated with the females in the clan. The other 97% were nomadic or interloper males. So that was what I was referring to, although in the context of the fight, oh, we might get a chance to see what's happening here. I think that's November. Nope, I definitely made a mistake. It's not a new set of cubs. Pretty telling June to go away. And that November's not up for playtime at the moment. It's dinner time. It's nice to see them so peaceful. And there's been a lot of speculation, and a lot of it's come from me as well. So Kat, in Massachusetts, you were asking if there was not a set of cubs here before Pretty and Corky moved here. James, Mr. Hendry, the wonderful Mr. Hendry, strongly suspected that there was. So he discovered this den, and he spent quite a bit of time here before Pretty and Corky moved here. And there was a female that was showing a lot of interest in the entrance tunnels, and she kept standing at the entrance and calling. And for the longest time, James suspected that she had cubs. I'm not saying that he was wrong. I think he was right. I'm just not sure exactly how that plays into the scenario that we witnessed this morning. And what I'd love to know is if we went back, and I'm still struggling to find a good comparison picture to try and figure this out, but I'm still working on whether or not that hyena was the same hyena that was attacked this morning. If it was, it would make sense. If we work on the fairly well-established assumption that the hyena that was attacked today was the mother of the twins from last year, that would be about right. I mean, it would be a tight squeeze. Hyenas usually breed anywhere from between 11 months to about a year and a half between litters. 11 months is quite unusual. It's a very short time period. The twins from last year were born in February, so it would be just about possible that it was her. And if I can ask you, to regular viewers who've been watching every show, if you stretch your minds back to a couple of days ago before the move, when we were sitting at Gallagher, at the den at Gallagher Shortcut, November started calling for the first time. And during that sighting, there was a female that I didn't know or didn't feel that familiar with. She wasn't Pretty and she wasn't Corky, but she was calling at the den entrances. Now, I'm not sure what has been happening here in their lives or in her life. I put forward a suggestion this afternoon, very tentatively, that she might have lost her cubs and her maternal instincts were still functioning, so she was moving from this den to the active den calling for her cub that she had potentially lost. That is a complete guess. It is absolute supposition. I have no idea if that's the case. I just think that if she really did have cubs, they would have shown themselves by now. I really strongly suspect that. I mean, we've seen cubs at a very, very young age. D1 and D2 made their first appearance on these live safaris when they were still tiny and wobbly. And I suspect we would have seen the new cubs by now, which is why I got excited now when I saw November here feeding, because I thought we might have finally seen them. But if we should have seen the cubs by now, it doesn't explain why she kept calling at the entrance to the den, which is what made me think about the possibility that she'd lost her cubs in some way. I don't know. I'm honestly, your guess is as good as mine. We can only guess at what's been going on. And the reason for that somewhat vicious attack that occurred earlier, I really don't know. I'm trying to, it also gets very complicated. I'm trying to think of a quick name for the mother of the twins, just so that I can... Somebody's squeaking. think that was November. Ah, yes, please come and tell me who you are. Oh no, that's Bella's mom. That's who that is. That is the matriarch, we suspect. She was the main aggressor today. Watch the way she interacts here. Now she's calling at the den. And standing on poor November. Pretty making placating noises. Look at how everybody's submissive to her. Yep, that's November. Pretty making supplicating contact calls. Now, Pretty was involved, as far as I can tell, in the attack that happened this morning. I suspect that she is quite high ranking, but not as high ranking. Look at this hyena, it's huge. She is such a big, stocky female. And injuries all around her front limbs from today. And you can see what I mean now when we look at her, what I mean by the dense spot patterns. A very densely spotted hyena. Sorry. I got the giggles. Bella just fell over a stick. Actually, what happened was that it stood on a stick that then flicked up and smacked it in the bottom and got a fright and squeaked. And that's why the matriarch that you're looking at the moment gave a squeak in surprise, or looked up in surprise when she heard Bella's squeak. Oh, there's D1 and D2, or at least one of them. I'm not sure as to what's going on. I think we can safely say, oh, Corky vanished. I don't know where she went. I think she went over the back side of the den. What's interesting to me, but it's hard to tell, I need to see her teeth, is that the stocky female really looks young to me. And I don't know whether it's just because she hasn't gone as bald around the neck and the head as some of the other hyenas. Who's coming in there? Oh, that was June. But she looks young to me. Which is interesting. She's definitely one of the biggest females I've ever seen, just in terms of bulk and the size of her head. And a couple of you sent through older screenshots of her as a mother when Bella, or Ntubela, was still quite tiny. And to me, it looks like it's definitely the same hyena, but she looks like she's grown. Which also makes me think that she's quite young. I wish I could have been there from the beginning in a way, so that I could tell you a little bit more as to what's going on. I have seen her be dominant and, or let's not say aggressive is the wrong word. I've seen her act dominant over every single hyena at this den. And even Pretty there, with the hyena standing on her cub and causing it to squeal, she still reacted submissively. Hello, big girl. Settling down now. Yeah? You were wondering if both of the den sites are active or if they've all moved here. As far as I can tell, they've all moved here. I wouldn't be surprised if every now and again the sub-adults, so Bella and June, pay the occasional visit to the Galago shortcut den, just because they're familiar with it and they are old enough now to wander about curiously. Cute. Hello, you two. coming to investigate an older cousin. It's been a long time since we've seen June's mother come here. Or certainly it has been for me. And I think she's starting to feel it a little bit. She's looking a little bit thin. Maybe it's my imagination, but she does look a bit thin to me. Hello, you two bundles of mischief. Aww. Mom's gone. And June has stepped in as a babysitter. Probably just looking for a playmate. There's definite affection there being shown. Amazing what a difference a few weeks or a month makes in terms of hyena cub development. Remember when these two were two tiny black blobs of squalling, wobbly messes that were stumbling all over the place? So brave. You can see how well worn that path is that it's standing on. Nope, not that brave. A little bit brave, but not that brave. Look how gentle June is being. Considering how sharp those little teeth probably are. I really enjoyed coming here for the last few moments of the sunset safari. Nice to just see peace and tranquility at this den site. And I hope for June's sake that we see her mother back fairly soon. There goes Bella's mom. Looks as though she's going to vomit. Yep, just having a bit of a puke. Something she ate might have disagreed with her. Bella going to greet his mom. Oh, June, be careful. You don't want to mess with her. So yes, just in answer to one final question, the den is all connected. So all of the tunnels, Debbie, are connected to each other, and the cubs can usually move from one entrance to another. That being said, the risk of one set of cubs killing another is there, but it's fairly unusual. Oh, there's another. Now I'm a bit confused. Was that Bella that was hiding down there? Oh, excuse you, madam. I heard that. Oh, now she's rolling in it. They're wonderful creatures. But not always the most cleanly. Yep. I suppose once it's out, you might as well roll in it. Make sure you're as smelly as possible. Yummy. I don't know why they do that. They definitely seem to enjoy rolling themselves in really pungent smells. Wild dogs do it as well. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I've really enjoyed spending the last few moments here. It's been a beautifully peaceful and wonderful African evening. Thank you all for joining us, and thank you as always for your contribution to our live safaris. Thank you, Tibbs, for your fantastic camera work, and the ever eloquent Jerry in final control, as well as Kirsty and Eugene. Have a lovely day wherever you are in the world, ladies and gentlemen, and we'll catch you tomorrow for the sunrise safari. Cheers for now.
All right. You might see that structure that's in the tree there, that vertical pole. That's the remnants of the tree house at Treehouse Dam. We are here just to say goodnight to you. We wanted to show you the tree house, and we wanted to show you the tree that's lovely, lovely and silhouetted against the sky there. Myself and VM, I want to wish you a good evening from our side, and or a rest of the day from where you're watching this from. We've had a fantastic afternoon, to be quite honest. We haven't been able to show you too much. We've been in and out of bad signal areas. The highlight has to be those three Batalier eagles. While we were in black screen, myself and VM did see the Bataliers mating with one another. So I can confirm that it was one male and two females, and that male was with the two females because he was trying to mate with one of them. How nice was that? And it was probably his partner that was there with him as well. Now, we're going to be closing out. Yeah, VM will show you how much water is in Treehouse. We will be catching up with you tomorrow again on the Sunrise Safari. I have to say thank you to Jerry and to Kirsty inside FC. You've been fantastic. And thank you very much for all your questions as usual. Enjoy the rest of your day. See you tomorrow.